So here we are, 1,300 strong. It's just amazing. We've never had more than 900. This is the largest number of people in this facility ever. And why are we here? We're here to honor Jim Zelter. I should stop now. Anyway, before I get into Jim, as we all know, behind every great man is an even greater woman. So Vivian, take a quick bow. I know you don't want to stand up, a wave. It's wife of 25 years. Also here are both their children. Lizzie, 23 years old. Lizzie. And Nate, who skipped Duke today. He had a test in the morning, and here he is. Nate. Thank you. So I'd like to welcome all the Zelters, their friends, and old colleagues. Welcome to our family. Welcome to our great annual dinner. I was a guest here once, about 30 years ago. And I got to tell you, it changed my life. It changed my life, and I hope it changes many of yours. And I hope you come back. I haven't missed a dinner in 30 years, and I hope you all come back a lot. And you're going to find out why later. So now, a quick review of Jim. He's had a storied career on Wall Street. He came from Duke, runs in the family. He went to Smith Barney, Goldman Sachs, Salomon Smith Barney, Citigroup, and finally, in 2006, he goes to Apollo. He goes to Apollo to start their small credit business. Over the next 15 years or so, maybe a little less if I'm better with my math, he grows it to $200 billion. It's the largest business at Apollo, and last year they made him co-president. Pretty goddamn good. So I got to know Jim about 8 years ago when I was the chief investment officer for the New York City pension funds. Jim ran a $100 million credit business at the time. And over several months of haggling and negotiating, we created a very innovative, opportunistic credit program specifically designed to take advantage of global markets. And I've personally got to see how Jim operates. Must say, pretty good. Happily, the city invested $600 million with Apollo. It's now worth more than a billion dollars. So the reality is that for the past 6 years, he's worked on behalf of 110,000 active and retired New York City police and firefighters. So long before this dinner, Jim has been thinking police and fire. And we're going to get to that in a second. What really stood out for me working with Jim was, I hate to say this while he's here, he's really a great guy. He's smart, he's creative, he's a very good communicator, a total straight shooter, good news and bad news, and he's a very flexible thinker, which you need to deal with New York City. And we need a lot, and he gave us a lot. Jim is a born-again Dukie. He loves basketball, and he's a golf junkie. He loves the Yankees, the Knicks, the Giants. How can that be bad? He's also a devoted family man. And as successful as Jim has been, he hasn't let it go to his head, and I'm told some people on Wall Street let that happen. But Jim has always answered the call. Whenever I asked him to buy a table out here, he bought one. He personally attended every event I've ever asked him to attend. That's 7 of them. He bought many of the auction items. Phil's gonna try to make you buy some auction items. He's always bought them. He's bought them, and he's actually never known what he was gonna do with the auction item. But he bought them anyway. Why? Because he wanted to help us. So I wasn't really that surprised when I asked Jim a couple years ago, I said, hey, you want to go have dinner at our firehouse. It's engine 22, ladder 33. It's over at 85th and Lexington. You know, come over for a night. I talked to the guys. It's okay. We'll buy him dinner, and we'll hang out in the firehouse. He says, okay, sure, and he's pretty excited. So remember, he travels the globe. He has a lot going on. But sure enough, on the appointed night at 8 o'clock, we're in our blue jeans. We hang out at the firehouse from 8 o'clock to midnight, and he's ecstatic. And I said, what are you doing tomorrow? Well, I'm getting on a 6:30 plane to Abu Dhabi. That's Jim. Why? Because he loves firefighters. So I asked him, I said, so why do you love firefighters and policemen? I said, what's with it? You know, it kind of, I don't think your father's in that business. Well, it turns out when Jim was growing up in a small town outside of Rochester, New York, his father, Charles, also known as Big Red, knew the police chief and the fire chief. And he knew a bunch of the firefighters and cops. And he told Jim that these were special people. And he held them with great respect and great esteem. And Jim saw that, and it stuck with Jim, that these are special people. So it turns out when he was younger, he hung out in firehouses. He would just sort of hang out, and I don't know why a kid hangs out in a firehouse, but he did. And what he saw was their unrelenting work ethic, devotion to service, irascible camaraderie, and brotherhood. And it stuck with him. It stuck with him, I think, in everything he's ever done. As he got older, it turns out on Friday and Saturday nights, his father, Big Red, would sit in his big brown chair listening intently to the police radio station in the background. And you'd say, why? Well, Big Red wanted to make sure that if something happened to his older sisters, he'd find out about it first. So Jim would be wandering around the house and the police radio station is on. Interesting. So it turns out that the entire Zelter family admire police and firefighters, as I think we all do here tonight. But it turns out Jim is also a very private person. I think, in fact, he has never been publicly honored by any organization. And that's not to say that he hasn't been asked. Quite to the contrary, people as successful as Jim are asked often, and particularly with his recent position at co-president of Apollo. The reality is, however, nothing resonated with him as deeply and as passionately as the families of our fallen heroes. I have one last thing to say. Jim is an extremely competitive person. He wouldn't have gotten where he is unless he was this way. So as we were talking about being the honoree, he said, so Larry, so what's the most you ever raised? So I said, well, it's $3.7 million, and the honoree gave us a check for $1 million. So he thought, I could see the wheels really spinning, and he said, I think I can top that. And it's been a personal challenge for him ever since, for the past 8 months. I'm sure you've all been talking to Jim. He's been talking to you. We're happy that you answered the call. So to date, it might sound like $4.1 million. It's actually $4.2 million we've raised so far. And we're going to have an auction, and we're going to, I think, top $4.5 million tonight. Please. However, before I bring Jim up to receive his award, because he's done such an awesome job, I want to ask his former college roommate to give us a little more insight into who Jim Zelter really is. So please welcome the commissioner of the NBA, Adam Silver.
Thank you, Larry. I actually am Jim's former college roommate. I'll get to that in a second. But before I talk about Jim, just on behalf of the NBA, let me thank all of you at NYPD, FDNY, and Port Authority PD for your service in protecting our city. As you know, there is a strong bond between you and all of our New York sports teams. And we are always grateful to you for keeping our fans, teams, arenas, and stadiums safe. So I know I speak for all leagues. Thank you very much. And to the families of the fallen who are here tonight, who have paid the ultimate sacrifice, I know there's nothing we can say or do that will bring back your loved ones. But we can all answer the call, and certainly we can all show up. And that brings me to my friend Jim, who really, as Larry said, has always shown up. I think other than his three sisters who are here tonight, and welcome, I've known Jim longer than anyone in this room, and it's hard to believe we met nearly 40 years ago at Duke University. Of course, again, we were college roommates, and I think I have stories that could make firemen blush, but I'm not going to share them. Jim, what wasn't mentioned was he was a lacrosse star at Duke. He was a great Division I college athlete, and contrary to what he told his kids, he hardly ever studied. But he actually did very well, and it's almost hard to believe that, frankly, Jim, I'm the one that ended up in sports. I was the nerdy guy doing my homework, taking economics courses, you know, thinking one day maybe I'd have a career in finance. And then somehow, I ended up in sports, and Jim has a job that, frankly, I don't understand. I didn't understand much of what you said, Larry, and I looked in his bio, and I asked my wife, Maggie, if she understood what he did. She said no. So we reread his bio last night, and I read to my wife, Maggie, that he runs, and I'm reading off his bio, integrated alternative investment platforms. And all I know is he does really well. So congratulations, Jim. And I will say that we lived in a tiny little dorm room. I don't know, 10 by 12 or something like that. We had two beds. We could hear each other breathe at night. But there were always a lot of people in our room, mostly to hang out with Jim. There were a lot of guests, Vivian. I don't know, a lot. There were a lot of guests in our room. And he was a gregarious guy. He was friendly, and it's why we are going to set the fundraising record tonight. Why, by the way, several of our Duke friends are here tonight. And I really mean this on behalf of all of Jim's friends. I mean, you know, it's our version of always showing up for his family, his friends. Jim is always everyone's first call. He keeps everybody's confidences. He, as Larry said, despite all his success, all those wonderful jobs he's been in, he's never been honored, he's never been asked to be honored, he's never asked anybody for anything, and he's the most selfless guy I know. So, Jim, on behalf of all of us, it's you're my best friend, it's wonderful to be here, and thank you very much, everyone.